Hey guys, it's Nir. In this part of the 2.5D game in Unity tutorial, we will make a shader with ShaderGraph that will allow us to blend 3D objects into our 2.5D environment in a harmonious way. Let's have a look at the final results of this shader. On the left, we have a regular object, and on the right, an object with our shader. Do you notice how the unmodified objects stick out while the modified objects blend in? To better understand the difference, let's look at how the shader affects primitive objects. The right object of each primitive is the modified one. It may look a bit weird when we isolate a 3D object, but as a whole, when it's surrounded by 2D sprites, it feels much more unified and ties the whole game together. If you haven't already watched the previous two parts, it's not mandatory, but I do recommend to go through at least the first part, so you better understand the essence of this unique 2.5D art style. I'm using Unity 2019.3, and this shader should work in later versions and even in earlier versions that support the Universal Render Pipeline, previously named the Lightweight Render Pipeline. This quick fix is useful if you have a static game object that doesn't need rotation. Even if you need a more advanced movement, this part explains the approach we are taking and is the base for a more advanced shader we will create later in this video. What we are trying to achieve is skewing the 3D models in the same angle as the 2D sprites. From a side view, it looks like this. The left line represents a 2D sprite, and the right box represents a 3D cube. What the shader does is skewing the cube to match the 45 degrees rotation of the 2D sprite. The way the shader works is by translating the Z position of each vertex with the same amount of its Y position. Okay, let's start working. In our scene, add some primitives. I'm adding a cube, sphere, capsule, and cylinder. In the project window, add a new shader by selecting the unlit graph. Name it Simple 3D Skew. First thing, let's add the capability to render a texture. Go to the blackboard, which is the panel on the left with the name of the shader. If you don't see the blackboard, open it by clicking the button on the upper right. Add a texture property by clicking the plus button and selecting Texture 2D. Name it Main Text. Add the property to the graph by dragging it to the canvas. To render the texture, we need to sample it with an appropriate node. Right-click on the canvas and search for the Sample Texture 2D node. Connect the RGBA output slot of the sample node to the color input slot of the master node. Also, connect the alpha output slot to the alpha input slot. Connect the properties output slot to the sample node's texture input slot. To verify our texture rendering works as intended, click the Save Asset button on the upper left. We can now go back to the scene view and create a new material. Right-click the shader we have created and select Create Material. Name it Simple 3D Skew and add a texture to its main text property. Assign the material to the objects in our scene by dragging it on them. We can now see that our shader works and renders a texture. Let's move on to the exciting part, skewing the objects. Back to the shader graph, we need to have access to each of the object's vertices position components. To do so, create a position node and set its space to object space. Create a split node and connect the output slot from the position node to the input slot of the splits node. We now have access to each of the vertex position components separately. Leave some empty space and create a combine node. We use it to combine the separate components into a single vector. Drag each output slot channel from the split node to the corresponding input slot of the combine node. Also, we need to connect the RGB output slot from the combine node to the vertex position input slot of the master node. Save the graph asset. If you followed correctly, you should have the same result as before, an unmodified model with the texture of your choice. We have one last change to make. Recall that we want to translate the Z position in correlation to the vertex Y position. Back in the shader graph, create an add node. In the split node, we have the RGB output slots, which correspond to the XYZ position components. Connect the G and B output slots to the input slots of the add node. Connect the output slot of the add node to the B input slot of the combine node. What we have done here is to retain the vertex current Z position and push it by the amount of the Y position. After saving the graph, our objects are now skewed as intended, matching the rotation of the sprites. When we select the object, notice how the outline is still rendering without the shader skew. This is because the shader only affects the rendering and not, let's say, physics colliders. Recall from the first video that this is actually good for us, as we treat physics colliders as they are full 3D objects without rotating them. The shader now works, but we have an issue. Take a look at what happens if we rotate an object. The skewing is always applied to the object relative to its origin transformation. But don't worry, we are going to handle it now. We can now take the shader to the next level by allowing transforming the objects. We can do it by applying the skewing effect in the world space instead of the object space. In the project window, add a new shader by selecting the unlit graph. Name it Advanced 3D Skew and open its ShaderGraph editor. Let's start with creating a texture property and sampling it just like in our simple 3D skew shader we have created. Our approach for this shader is to take the vertices in the world position, manipulate them, and then convert them back to object space. So let's lay down the foundation for it. Create a position node. Make sure it's in world space. Create a split node and connect the position node into it. We now have the world position components separated from each other. At the end of the manipulation, we want to convert the positions from world space to object space. For that, create a combine node and a transform node. Set the transform node to position type and select world space to object space. Connect the RGB output slot from the combine node into the transform node input. Connect the out slot from the transform node to the vertex position input slot of the master node. For now, let's skip the actual implementation of the position skewing and make sure everything is wired correctly. Connect each output slot from the split node to the corresponding input slot of the combine node. Save the graph asset and go back to the scene view. To validate what we have done, let's create a material by right-clicking the shader and selecting Create Material. We will name it Advanced 3D Skew. Set the texture property with a texture of choice. We can now assign the material to our primitives in the scene instead of the basic shader material. If you followed along, you should now have the primitives without any manipulation, but with the texture we have assigned. Back to the shader graph, let's skew the Z position of the vertex, just like the basic shader. Create an add node and connect to it the G and B output slots from the split node. This is the sum of the Y and Z position. Connect the add node's output slot to the B input slot of the combine node. Click the Save Asset button. Back in the scene view, we can now see that the objects are skewed, and we can also rotate them without breaking the shader. But we still have another issue with it. Have a look what happens when I move the objects upwards. Instead of just pushing the object up, it also pushes it back. The issue we encountered happens because we add the Y position of a vertex in world space. If the object is high in the scene, it will push the Z position beyond our intentions. What we want to do is to take the Y position of the object's origin point and reduce it from our skew. This will ensure we only skew Z relative to our object position. Let's add our final touch to the shader graph. Create a transform node. Leave its input vector as is, where all components are zero. Set the spaces as object to world. Make sure the type is set to position. We only need the Y component, so create a split node and connect the transform node to it. Create a subtract node and connect the adds output slot to the input slot A of the subtract node. Connect the G output slot of the split node to the input slot B of the subtract node. The last thing, connect the output slot of the subtract node to the input slot B of the combine node. Click the Save Asset and now back to the scene view. That's it, we finally have our skewing shader that is capable of transforming the position and rotation. You may encounter a glitch while transforming an object or moving the camera. This happens because of the renderer pipeline's batching. While we can go to the render pipeline setting and turn off batching, it is better to modify shader's materials. Select the material Advanced 3D Skew and select Enable GPU Instancing. If you want to download the shaders we have created, you can download the Unity project from GitHub. The link is in the description. Let me know in the comments if you plan to add 3D objects to your 2.5D game. What object will it be? In the next parts of this tutorial series, we will make a shader to add neat gates and doors for our 2.5D game. We will also configure Cinemachine for our 2.5D style with interactive multicam switching. For more game dev tutorials about Unity and spine animation, be sure to like and subscribe. We also post our own games devlog, so you can see how we use this 2.5D style in our own game dev process. See you in the next part!